Hi everyone. So I'm going to continue talking about topic 10 here. We're going to get into topic 10C, which discusses a couple of concepts that we used to talk about in a later chemistry class, but now we're going to talk about it in this first semester of chemistry. And this is really the topic of vapor pressure, and we'll talk also about phase diagrams, which is the conversion of a particular substance from its solid state to its liquid state to its vapor phase. And so what I want to talk about first is just, of course, the three different states of matter, where in this case it's shown as water here. You have the solid state, you have the liquid state, and you have the gas state. And remember that what we've talked about in this topic so far is what forces are holding the liquid and solid states together. Such that they stay more condensed, since you can see the density of the liquid and solid state are fairly similar to each other, but the density of the gas phase is very, very much less than the liquid and solid state. And the reason is because in the gas state, of course, we envision that there's no intermolecular attraction whatsoever, so as a result, they occupy very large volume with respect to the mass that's available. Now, in terms of changes, you know that we can change the solid state to the liquid state by adding heat, and then we can also, if we keep adding heat, at some point the liquid state will become the gas state. And the heat or the energy that's being added here is really what it's doing. It's really breaking apart all of those intermolecular forces that we talked about. So if you have hydrogen bonding, for example, between the water molecules in the solid state, by adding energy, that causes the hydrogen bonding pattern to be disrupted and in such a way that it forms the liquid state. And then at some point, if you put enough energy to heat up the liquid water, at some point, all those hydrogen bond that exists in the liquid will also be disrupted, and then you're going to get the gas phase of water. And there's certain terms associated with these conversions, which I list here, and these are terms that you might have seen before, so I don't want to belabor this, and by reading it one at a time, you can look at this yourself and read them through. Just remember that you can also bring this process back if you start to cool things down a little bit, and you can either cool things down, which is what we it's the opposite process from heating or from adding energy. But the other thing that you might not think so much about is also you can increase pressure. If you were to increase pressure, in other words, you lower volume, for example, of this container, at some point all these gases are going to be forced to be close together. And when they're close together, then the intermolecular forces are going to start to be important again, because of course at very close distances the attractions become quite important. And this is really a concept that we talked about when we talked about gases as well. When we talk about real gases versus ideal gases, we talked about the idea that as pressure becomes higher and higher, these gases are going to behave less and less ideally because the intermolecular forces start to become important. And this is really the case. At some point, if you increase enough pressure, the whole molecule, mass of molecules, would convert and become what we call a liquid. And then, if you keep increasing pressure, eventually it will become a solid. As a reminder from before, the temperature, the amount of temperature you have is proportional to the amount of kinetic energy that the molecules have. So, if you think about two temperatures, okay, this is again discussed in the topic where we talk about gases. We talk about something referred to as the Maxwell distribution. If you imagine these two temperature of gases, for example, you notice that the one at the higher temperature, which is the one marked by the red curve, would have molecules that are at higher kinetic energy. If you imagine, for example, this to be the amount of energy that is needed to convert the molecules from, let's say, the liquid state to the gas state. So at higher temperature, obviously, you have more molecules that can overcome that particular energy barrier to become the gas state. So that's, why we see that there's, as you increase temperature, basically there is a more and more molecules would exist in the in the gas phase versus the liquid state, for example. This is what we refer to as a physical equilibrium, because at a given temperature, you basically have both of these things existing. Let's say you're at 50 degrees Celsius, both of these would exist for water. As you increase temperature, more of this would be present and fewer of the liquid will be present. Of course, at 100 degrees, you have boiling, where all the liquids at that point would, at that temperature, would be converted to gases. And eventually, once all the liquids have been converted to gases, then the gases will continue to increase its temperature if energy is being inputted. Now, the process of vaporization is basically the process where the liquid is being converted to the gas phase. Now, here again, we're showing this for water. Molecules on the surface, as we talked about in the previous topic, have, you know, less interaction, fewer interaction holding it together compared to this molecule that's within the liquid itself. So as a result, if the interaction is weak enough, at some point it will be able, depending on temperature again, it will be able to actually escape. So it's really a matter of, in this case, a tug of war in terms of forces between the intermolecular forces, the hydrogen bonding forces for water in this case, versus the actual kinetic energy of the molecule itself. So if the kinetic energy is high enough, then the molecules can actually escape that hydrogen bonding. But of course, it's, again, even if the molecules can escape, it's a lot easier for the molecules on the surface to escape because there's fewer hydrogen bonding holding it together. There's fewer intermolecular forces holding it together. Now, the idea of vapor pressure is as follows. If you have a container of a liquid, let's say sealed up like this, the liquid, the liquid on the surface at some point is going to evaporate. Again, given its certain kinetic energy, it'll be able to evaporate. And at some point, you're going to have a bunch of gas phase molecules existing on the top of the liquid. And this process is dynamic in the sense that some of those gases are going to condense back to the liquid form. And you're going to get this conversion back and forth between the gas phase to the liquid and the liquid phase to the gas until at some point the rate of conversion becomes equal. In other words, the rate of the liquid converting to gas is exactly the same as the rate of the gas converting to liquid. At that point, the total amount of gas found on the top of this container right here is what we refer to as the vapor pressure of that liquid. So for example, in this case, if this were water, at a given temperature, you would have a certain vapor pressure because at a given temperature, there's a certain amount of kinetic energy. That kinetic energy allows some number of water molecules to escape the liquid intermolecular forces to become the gas phase. Vapor pressure of water specifically is a concept we discussed also in the gas topic when we talked about accounting for vapor pressure of water in collecting gaseous products. So you might want to look back at those concepts in your notes or rewatch the videos and, you know, try to remember exactly how this vapor pressure comes about. Now, vapor pressure is not a phenomenon just, you know, that appears for water. Any liquid will have a certain vapor pressure associated with it because every liquid has a certain amount of intermolecular forces present. Given temperature and pressure of that liquid, some of those molecules can escape the intermolecular forces and become gases. Now, what's you expect, of course, and this is shown by experiment, is that the vapor pressure of a liquid depends on temperature, and that should make sense, right? Because we talked about it just now, that if the temperature of this particular collection of liquid is higher, then more of those molecules will have enough kinetic energy, as shown in that plot before, to actually escape the intermolecular forces and become gases, right? Become vapor. And as a result, you're gonna, if you have more vapor, more particles in the gas state, then your vapor pressure will be higher. So if you look, for example, at a plot of vapor pressure as a function of temperature for water, you can see here we're starting about 0 degrees, where there's really no vapor pressure or very low vapor pressure, but you start seeing a measurable amount of vapor pressure, maybe about 5 degrees Celsius, and it goes all the way to the top here to 100 degrees, when at that point the vapor pressure is exactly equal to 760 torr, or 1 atmosphere. So One important definition you want to keep in mind is, and you might, you should write this down at this point, the temperature at which the vapor pressure of a particular liquid is equal to one atmosphere is what we call the normal boiling point for that liquid. Okay, so for water, the vapor pressure of water reaches one atmosphere when your temperature is at 100 degrees Celsius. Now, this is not the same for every liquid. As you can see here, for something like ethanol, ethyl alcohol, which is your alcohol, drinking alcohol component, you notice that it actually boils at 78.3 degrees Celsius, which is, again, that's defined as the temperature at which liquid ethanol will have a vapor pressure of one atmosphere. Now, when we look at the plot for water versus ethyl alcohol, then we can conclude that ethanol is a more volatile liquid. Okay, so the word volatile is used to indicate that it boils off at a lower temperature compared to water. So more volatile just means that at a given temperature, if you compare these two liquids, water and ethanol, ethanol has a much higher vapor pressure at the same temperature. So for example, if we look at 60 degrees here, the vapor pressure of water is about, I don't know, 150 torr, for example, but the vapor pressure of ethanol is all the way here, which is about, let's say, 350 torr. So it's quite a bit higher than what water is. Now you look at a liquid like diethyl ether, which actually boils off at 34.6 degrees. That's the boiling point. You notice that that species actually is very, very volatile, right? Even at 60 degrees, it's already all gas, right? So it's at 35 degrees, it's already all gas. Okay, so at 20 degrees, you can see that the vapor pressure of diethyl ether is already about 400 torr, whereas water is only about, maybe 20 or something like that. So it's very, very low in comparison to that. So water is, not very volatile when compared to diethyl ether. However, you look at on the other end of the spectrum here, you look at ethylene glycol. Now, this is really, really not volatile at all because even at 100 degrees, it's barely registering any vapor pressure at all. So, in comparison to ethylene glycol, then water is not, a very volatile substance. So, you have to kind of compare this when you make the statement about whether something is volatile or not. You really have to compare it with some other substances and say, is this more volatile than one substance or is it less volatile than other substances? And volatility in this case, again, it describes basically how much vapor pressure you have at a given temperature. If you have a lot, higher vapor pressure, then the liquid is considered volatile and it's a property of a liquid.